Hey guys, I'm Jack, and this is episode 5 of Turning on to Harbor. So this week, I am super duper excited to have on somebody who I call my new good friend, Nick Groom. How's it going, Nick?
What's going on, buddy? Thanks for having me on.
Absolutely. So over here on Turning on to Harbor, we are talking all about Christmas this week, as you can see from the decorations behind me. And Nick runs another podcast that I just started listening to after you helped host the DCast, correct?
Yeah, that was a good show. Good people over there. I love it.
Yeah. Love Dale and Andy. They're doing some good work over there, but it helped me find your feed, and then I just started listening and got super stoked on it, and I was like, this guy totally would be super fun to have on the show. So, Nick, tell me a little bit about the Disney Dude. Tell me about the podcast.
Well, the Disney Dude, it's my place to talk. All too often in my real everyday life, I get told you're talking about Disney far too much. Well, guess what? There's like thousands of the other people out there just like me that don't get tired of hearing me talk, which is shocking in of itself. People actually want to hear me talk. But no, I decided one day to kind of bring my love of Disney to everybody else and to kind of try to inject a little bit of cool back into Disney. All too often recently, there's this stigma about Disney being for kids or girls even. But being a 20-something year old male, it's kind of taboo to like Disney. It's a little weird. People give you a strange look, like, you're into what?
Yeah.
And I'm trying to inject that coolness back into it because it is cool, man. It's an awesome story, great theme parks, and just, It's all awesome. What else is there to say, you know?
Absolutely, yeah. So that kind of goes into the title, the Disney Dude. Like, you're just kind of trying to bring the radness of Disney into a community of people who would sometimes almost frown on that. Like, for instance, I'm a sophomore in high school, and, you know, I have to keep it kind of a bit of a secret that I'm such a big fan of Disney, that I host a podcast, that I'm on YouTube for it. There are a couple of close friends that know me really well and also enjoy Disney that I can share that with. But a lot of the people, I just have to, you know, keep it to myself because I'm either judged or it is considered uncool. So what you're doing over there at the Disney Dude is pretty rad because it's kind of trying to show everyone that, you know, we can be guys and still appreciate the vastness of the Disney, the reach of Disney and everything that it encompasses, I guess.
Yeah, 100%. I mean, like I said, Disney, it's all about story first, and people see princesses and magic and all that, and they kind of, like I said, they have this little taboo stigma in their head, or it's like, that's for kids. Well, you know what? Fine, I'll take that, because right now the world is in a place where I don't want to be a grown-up. It's not fun. It's not a good thing to be an adult right now. And so if I can get a little bit of an escape into Disney, into an animated feature or a live action just fantasy film, I'm gonna take it and I'm gonna jump into it. I mean, it's no different than somebody going to watch Game of Thrones. The only difference is there's less blood and like all that stuff going on.
You can kind of share it with some more people. It's not just for like that one specific demo. It spans from ages 2 to 102. That's the cool thing.
Exactly, and like I said, it's. I was in your position. I was growing up in high school, and I talked about it in a couple other podcasts where I thought Disney wasn't cool anymore. And it wasn't until I got out of high school and really found a footing and was comfortable with who I was that I was able to be like, you know what? I like Disney. And to see me, I'm not really that kind of guy. I mean, I've got a full sleeve I'm working on.
That's awesome.
I'm a power lifter. Right, I'm a power lifter. So when you see me, I've got King Mickey from Kingdom Hearts all over my forearm. And so I'm at the gym like working out, and people are like, "Nice ink, man. What you got?" And I'm like, "I got Mickey Mouse." And they're like, "No, really. What do you got?" And I'm like, "Mickey Mouse." I'm like, "What are you going to do about it? I'm lifting more than you. Say something."
Yeah.
I'm like, you know.
That's awesome.
No,
yeah.
But I try to explain to them too, you know, like, "Hey, it's okay." And you would be surprised how many of my friends, after I finally came out, was like, it's cool to like Disney. They're like, well, I was thinking about seeing that new movie, Moana. And I'm like, ah, see, man, don't lie to me. Like, it's cool. You just don't want to admit it because you're afraid of what everybody else is thinking. If everybody was just like, hey, I don't care what everybody else is thinking, I guarantee you we would have a community that was just as large as any other.
Oh, my gosh. And that would be so cool to just have everybody not have to think about it, you know, because there's so much thought that goes into it, whereas, oh shoot, if I say that, then maybe they'll think this, whereas if we all just went, you know, this is super rad, you should check it out, be like, I was thinking the same thing, but I just wasn't going to tell you because I was worried about what you would think. If people didn't have that precursor, it would just be so much more fun, and as you said, we would have a giant community of people who really just kind of love these fandoms, and we would all be together in a community instead of divided by our little ideas of what makes us cool. Because I'm the same way. I'm a sophomore. I don't really try and put it out there. Obviously, I work on music and film, and I just kind of try and stay that, like, the right Switzerland kid, I guess, just trying to fit in and stay there. But then, like, once you get to know me, I guess it's a little bit different. It's like, what do you do for fun? Well, I kind of podcast. What do you podcast about? Disney? Like, what?
Yeah, exactly. There's a big stigma. And I think with people, you know, like yourself, and you were saying earlier, Network 1901, all the guys over there, Josh, Taylor, Dale, Andy, they're injecting that cool into Disney as well. Josh especially is doing some really crazy off-the-wall stuff over there, and it blows my mind every time he comes out with something, because he's really pushing the envelope of what Disney is, not even just like what it is to be a guy that likes Disney, but like he's getting into like social, economical, like political status of Disney, and it just blows my mind every time. But like you said, if we can get past that whole barricade to liking Disney and worrying about what other people are thinking, there's a lot of good stuff out there. And I think with the advent of Marvel and Star Wars with Disney, you'll see a lot more of that, a lot more people being open to it. They'll get in the parks and, you know, they'll be like, you know, I went to Disney World, it wasn't that bad. You know,
yeah.
Like,
Yeah, and
I guess a lot of people don't understand what there is to do at Disney. I know me and my wife are going this year, and I got you were just there. we're doing the dining on the monorail, and we're going to be sitting down with like a five-star chef who's going to talk to us about, you know, the type of wine that goes with the type of cheese, and I don't have any idea about any of that, but if I were to go up to a random person and say, hey, I'm going to meet with a five-star chef, they'd be like, oh, cool, where are you going? I'm like, Disney World. They're like, wait, with the castle and Mickey Mouse? And I'm like, yeah. I'm like, oh, okay. So there is no Disney World that is set in stone. It's all what you make of it when you go down there, or Disneyland. You can have any type of experience you want when you go to Disney in general. And that's what I love about
Absolutely. And that's the cool thing about the company and how it continues to expand. Like you said, with Marvel and Star Wars, and now with Downtown Disney and with Disney Springs, there's all this bigger stuff, and like even ABC and ESPN. It's like, did you know that you're actually watching Disney as you're eating your chicken wings and you're watching your football game on Saturday? It's like, really?
That's right.
That's Disney? It's like, yeah, they're everywhere, and the fact that they can put it all together and people are enjoying it, they're like, it's funny though, because once you say Disney, they're like, oh, really? And yeah, that's what it is. Like, you're enjoying this. I don't know.
It's the take Disney, the effort that they put into things when they do them. Disney doesn't go half in on anything. So whether it be, like you said, ESPN or ABC, or even what we're seeing now with Netflix and the Marvel shows, they're not going in halfway. I mean, if I look at you and I say Daredevil, the Netflix show, is Disney.
Yeah.
Think about that. Go watch it and then think about it. Don't watch it with young kids, but in general,
Seriously.
It's very dark. It's very morbid. And it's changing the perception of Disney. And I just can't wait to see that come to full circle and to have that community where it's okay to go to Disney. It's okay to like Disney. And for somebody, especially, you know, of your age, being in high school, to be like, I'm going to see Moana this weekend, and all your friends being like, yo, I'm trying to go. Like, when are we hanging out?
Yeah, for sure. And I definitely have that group of people that are like, dude, that is sick. Like, I need to go with you. Like, we need to do this together. And it's awesome because as it progresses, as we said, I think people will just continue to keep coming to it and being like, this is so well done that we're going to keep loving it. We're going to keep going back to it. So, yeah, that's really cool. So, as you can see behind me, I've got some Christmas lights. I have the usual set. But, guys, oh yeah, and my TeePublic Star Wars Christmas shirt that I have here. But, guys, it is Christmas time.
No, I love Christmas. It's a great time of year, especially with Disney. I mean, it's the things that they do, they go all out for Christmas as well. Not as much as they used to, but I think they're getting back into to really pushing the envelope with that, especially with, like, their drone show. Have you seen this?
Okay, so I've been hearing about this. I am, every time Inside the Magic tweets, I get a notification. So I've seen multiple tweets of like, guys, this is crazy. You need to watch this drone thing. And then I still have not seen it, but I've heard about it with people that have been talking on different podcasts and stuff. But it sounds insane. And I'm so curious of how they're gonna, like, how it works with all the sound, because drones, as you know, make a ton of noise. So, like, how does that work?
I'm not sure. I personally haven't seen it. I've got a trip planned coming up. I'm leaving on the 16th to head down there. So I've refused to watch any of this when it came out. But okay, I've been watching the patents ever since it was first filed. And Disney has been playing around with this idea, I'd say, for about a year now. I've seen the paperwork floating around the internet.
Yeah, and that's what I've heard rumors-wise for sure, is that it's been about a year or so. But yeah, keep going.
It's very crazy what they're doing. The first patent did not indicate it was coming to Disney Springs. And I don't think that the Disney Springs is the final iteration. I think this is just them showing what they can do. Right. The first iteration I saw of this in the paper was with fireworks. So this is what's got my mind percolating. I've heard that the show, it's very cool, it's very short, and it's kind of just a show of force. I'm thinking they're testing some fireworks at the Magic Kingdom late at night. We already know that. People at hotels around there are saying it. I think Wishes isn't long for the parks, and I think we're going to get something even more spectacular that is mixing lasers with LEDs on drones with fireworks, and it's just going to be this crazy explosion of magic that's just all over the place. It's going to be the greatest thing ever, and I can't wait to see that.
It'll feel like electronica plus Wishes plus Paint the Night plus what was the other one that I was going to say? No, but it feels like all these shows are just going to be combined. Oh, and Fantasmic. It seems like, because there's always story that goes along with it, whether it be the music or the projections on the castle. But it all feels like it's just going to come full circle, and it's just going to be this giant, massive show. And I feel like you're right. I think that they're probably testing this for something that is going to be even more massive and even cooler than we even can speculate it to be.
No, I agree 100%. And like everybody always says, if anybody can do it, Disney can. So I can't wait to see what they have. It's gonna be crazy.
Yeah, definitely. So my broad question of what are your thoughts on Christmas? We're talking a little bit about Christmas in the parks. Obviously, there used to be the Osborne Spectacle of Dancing Lights, which just recently took its final show a couple years ago, right?
Yeah, I think it was they extended it to January of 2016, I believe, just because it was the last one. But I think you guys have it the best out there, man. If I'm not mistaken, we had Osborne, which is cool, but you guys get full ride makeovers. Am I mistaken here?
Yeah. So that goes a little bit into what we're gonna talk about next. I was just listening to an episode of it was Modern Mouse Radio, where you were on with Josh, and you guys were talking about DQuest, and you guys did a little bit of armchair imagineering and figured out what you guys could do with that spot, correct?
Yeah, that was, oh man, I loved that episode. It's actually my number one episode, actually.
Oh,
yeah,
that's
everybody
what
loves
it was.
That one.
Yeah. So I was super stoked on that, and I thought, well, we have a couple different overlays for Christmas on some of the rides here at Disneyland for Nightmare Before Christmas and for Small World. And so I was thinking, Nick, that we could sit down a little bit and figure out a new overlay that we could try on some rides. So what were you thinking for a cool holiday overlay?
So my thoughts, and being a Disney World baby, I'm going to jump to Disney World because I don't know Disneyland.
Yeah.
I haven't been out there just yet planning it, but here's what I'm thinking.
Okay, tell me.
We head over to Hollywood Studios, okay, and we jump on Rock and Roller Coaster. And you're thinking, like, what is that going to, what are you doing there? I say you throw Trans-Siberian Orchestra for the music, And then you got to have the story, right? So the story is Santa's MIA, whatever. So a rock band then has to become Santa, and they would overlay in the actual ride with Christmas lights and all that stuff. But the main thing would be that music. You would have that Trans-Siberian Orchestra music, and there'd be red and green all throughout, and it would just be this high speed delivery of presents. And I think really cool.
That would be so cool. I just went to Disney World this summer. I was there in July. So I just recently went on Rock and Roller Coaster about 5 times in a row. It was the greatest thing ever. I think one of the best rides in the entire company, just because of the soundtrack and the cool visuals that you have as you're going through it. But at the beginning, for those of you who have not been there, at the beginning you walk into a recording booth and you've got the entire Aerosmith gang talking to you about catching your limousine to the show. And so if we're talking about Trans-Siberian Orchestra and a band that comes to take over so that they can deliver the Christmas presents, how do you think that would go into that first little scene? Like, how would you set it up?
I almost wouldn't necessarily have the band in there. I would almost have like Santa's elves or Santa's helpers or holiday helpers, what have you in there, where it's somebody saying like, you could almost have it like a tree with no presents under it, and elves burst in and they're like, oh my gosh, it's Christmas Day and there are no presents under this tree. You guys got to go handle this. You guys got to get out on there on the road and deliver these presents to all these kids so they're not upset on Christmas morning. And that's when you head down, and maybe they even kind of have a special red and green car that you ride in. I don't know.
Cool.
I mean, it wouldn't be that hard. You know, you could just paint one of them.
Yeah, absolutely. I think that would be really cool. And so then you've got you need to go out there and save Christmas, so you get in your red and green. You could do like a limousine, but it's like a sleigh at the same time. Like, you could do,
yeah,
there's definitely something that you could work in there. And then you blast off, you go in, and then you go through a couple loop-de-loops, different spots. And so while you're on the ride, would there be a people talking in your ears on the soundtrack? Because you'll have,
yeah, you can totally do that,
obviously, but like, you would have like, how are you envisioning on the ride? Obviously you're going quick. How are you gonna portray the presents being delivered? How would that work?
You could almost get some of those giant projectors that they have, that they use for like wishes and whatnot, and you could have them mounted under the track, and as you're going along, you just see kind of like projections of presents being shot off of the
the
sled onto different areas, and you could have like you could just go in there with some basic sets of Christmas lights and wrap them around all the different objects that are already in Rock and Roller Coaster to kind of give it that Christmas pep.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. And so you could also use some of the projections that they use for Space Mountain Ghost Galaxy, because they do the projections onto the sides of the walls, and then also with Hyperspace Mountain with the Star Wars ships that they do. So you could use those projectors to do kinds of things on the walls, and then also do it with the presents. I think that would be incredibly cool. Do you think that there could be any sort of like 3D aspect in there? Obviously, it's a roller coaster, so it's definitely going through it, but what do you think?
I would be interested to see. I know that a lot of places are doing some really interesting things. I know Six Flags is doing a VR coaster. It's a coaster that's like you put on VR, but then you ride a roller coaster, so it kind of correlates. It would be cool to see maybe like you said, a 3D aspect to it. Maybe you get like some Muppets style 3D glasses that you put on, and these projections are actually 3D. That'd be kind of cool.
Yeah, that would be cool. And I've seen the VR roller coasters at Six Flags and such. But what I would worry about is the quality of that VR experience, because what I've seen is that these are super kind of 3D rendered, but very, very kind of crude. So I was, I think your
idea disheartening.
About the...
It's disheartening to see that. You would think that the main aspect of their VR ride is the experience within the VR. And to look at how much it would cost to completely render a realistic 3D environment, you're looking at maybe $1 to $2 million, and that would give you some grade A. You only need it for 2-3 minutes tops. Mm-hmm. $1 million would easily cover that. I guess they're trying to save a little cachet. I don't think Disney would go that route. I think they would go
Gambino. Say if it was Disney, you know that it would be like Disney could do it so much in a way, because obviously they're trying to save some cash because they're Six Flags and not Disney. Whereas Disney, I feel, has the tools that they would be able to do that. And I completely agree. I think that there could be a better way to do it. But at the same time, it's still VR. It's still trying to make sure that everything goes smoothly and correctly. So I think the idea of the 3D glasses, like a Muppet Vision kind of thing, would be your best bet, because, you know, you never know what could happen with the VR. And you would want to be able to experience the things that would usually be a part of Rock and Roller Coaster, because then you can kind of point out the parallels. I think would be really cool. Just be like, oh yeah, so you usually go through that, but now it's like a wreath instead of the O and the Hollywood sign. Stuff like that would be really cool.
Yeah, exactly. I think that's a great idea. It'd be cool. I would totally ride it.
All right, Disney. There you go. We've just given you an idea for an overlay for Rock and Roller Coaster.
Exactly. Bob Iger, send the check to me. We'll split it.
Yeah. Absolutely. Okay, so what I was thinking for mine is I kind of went back through the movies, and I'm like, what movie/ride at Disneyland and Disney World, I wanted to go both ways, what would work with the Christmas theme? And the first thing that I thought of was the end of Toy Story, where they are, the end of Toy Story the movie, where they're having Christmas, and they end up getting a Mrs. Potato Head, and chaos ensues. It's really funny. So I was thinking, what if we did Midway Mania with a Christmas overlay?
That could be very cool, and it would be very easy to do. I think that's something that would wouldn't be that hard to implement, but that's definitely a really cool idea. What did you have in mind?
So the thought was, at Disneyland, you've got Mr. Potato Head out front as an animatronic, and he's does his Midway Mania song in his little joke spiel. So he could kind of be telling the story a little bit as you're walking through the queue. Obviously, your queue is a whole lot better than ours at Disneyland. Ours is just weaving through a couple rooms, whereas yours is completely decked out. I was super stoked to go on that one. That was like the first ride that we went on that day at Hollywood Studios, and there was nobody in line, so we just got to go right through it. But it was cool because you're surrounded by walls of different themed spots, whereas with Disneyland, you've got just kind of chains and ropes. So that would be the reason to use the animatronic to kind of tell the background story of, you know, it's Christmas and Andy and his sister have just opened up some presents, and check it out, they are these carnival games-ish, but they would have to be Christmas themed. I don't know how that would work. But they would be opening up these new presents, and they want to try them out. So you get to go help them test their new presents. And so Mr. Potato Head would be explaining that. And then what you could also do in Disney World is you could have monitors all over, since you guys have the enclosed queue. You could have monitors that are kind of explaining it, maybe even a video, an animated video of Mr. Potato Head saying that. Or you could even have different images of the new gifts that they have just gotten about, you know, how you're going to do it. And it would also be kind of cool because some people go into this going, you know, what, how do I do this? Obviously, you just pull the little, the cannon, but it'd be kind of cool to do like a little tutorial video, you know. I don't know. I was just thinking that you could use that for the background, and then as you get into it, obviously, you would just have to create the games a little more Christmassy. And then it'd be cool because we've been on Midway Mania so many times to where you get the same game every time, which is cool, but the fact that we would be able to kind of switch it up would be really, really rad.
Yeah, I mean, that is a ride that it's fun, but like you said, it can get a little repetitive, and it could be cool. You could have, for instance, I know that they always send the troops out to scout out what's going under the tree. You could have a scene where there's the tree, and you're launching army men to the tree to check out the presents. I mean, there's a lot you could do
cool
there,
too,
and it's really cool.
Absolutely, and yeah, I think that the army men on the tree would be cool, and then obviously, you've got the 3D elements with the air that could be blasting, and then maybe you could even do like a little bit of foam for snow, like that kind of thing.
Yeah.
And you could just have
super rad.
All these different characters participating in these new Christmas things. And, oh, my other thought was we could do it kind of like how they have created in the new Star Tours, The Adventure Continues, how they have all the different scenes, and then they stack them together, so they have like... Do you know how many it is? I think it's like 16 different scenes, and they put them together.
Yeah, it's right. Like, so it's three on each. I believe there's three or four of each.
Mm-hmm.
And then so that's what, four times. I'm not a probability person, but it's a lot. You have a bunch of different variations you can get. I know that when episode 7 came out, they had locked it to the episode 7 one. But I think that'd be awesome too. Like you said, you could have one of each of the Toy Story movies where you could kind of have a
cool
variation every time you go through. It'd be really cool.
You know, it'd be really fun is the bonus round, you know, the one where you hit it, you just do it as fast as possible. You could have Al running through Al's toy barn, and you have to launch eggs at him or something where it's
like
Christmas themed. And I don't know, that could be kind of cool, but that could also even go into a revamp of the ride itself where they get a couple more. It would be more like you get three different scenes, or I think it's actually four different games. So you would get four different games every single time, and then it would switch it up a little bit, because like you said, it starts to get a little bit tedious after you've done it a couple different times.
Yeah. 100% agree. I think that's a great idea. I would love to see that ride. I know it's very popular still right now, but I don't think Disney should wait for it to get to die down. I think they should just keep an eye on it, and when there's a time, you know, God forbid you take the ride down, but when there's time and the money, like you said, give it a little bit of a revamp, not a big one, just maybe a couple different scenes to kind of keep it fresh and exciting.
Yeah, and the cool thing about this one is I think they would be able to do it in a very short amount of time because there wouldn't be as much to do with it. You know, it would just maybe be animating a new opening scene and then just kind of having some bells and some snow and different things that could add to the Christmassy vibe. But I think that would be really kind of an interesting idea, and it would be pretty cost effective considering some of the revamps that they're doing right now.
Oh yeah, 100%. 100% agree. And like you said, there'd be very little downtime because most of the work would be done prior to even to implementing it. So
Yeah, absolutely. Any more thoughts on Christmas at the parks, Nick?
I honestly think I'm very excited about it. I cannot wait to get down there. It's my first Christmas actually going to Walt Disney World. So I will have a whole bunch more information when I get back. Maybe we'll have to do like a recap where I let you know all the good stuff that happened. But it's I'm really looking forward to all the real. We're doing Mickey's Very Merry Christmas Party too. First time doing that. Can't wait.
Awesome. Yeah, you absolutely need to do like a recap show, or I'd love to talk to you again about kind of what went on there and how they incorporated all the very different things, because I've never been there at Christmas to either Disneyland or Disney World, and so it would be really cool to kind of see what's going on there. And I'm also curious, obviously they have specific things, but do they, you guys have had Main Street Electrical Parade for a long time out there, and then I've heard that we're going to get it over here in Disneyland, but I'm curious, do they do any Christmassy kind of thing with electrical parade, since it all is really Christmas lights?
Main Street Electrical Parade, I don't want to talk about that, it breaks my heart, but no, I'm just kidding, I'm kidding. That's my favorite parade ever, and the fact that you guys are getting it, I'm jealous, even though I've had it for so long. I'm still, it's like seeing an ex with somebody else, you're just like,
Hey man, it gives you an excuse to come out and see me, so.
Yeah, exactly. As of right now, we do not have a nighttime parade, as far as I know, at Magic Kingdom. I know they're doing the Christmas parade. But as far as ongoing, we don't have anything right now. And I think that leads into the whole new experiences coming to Walt Disney World between Wishes and no electrical parade. I think we're going to get something very big. And I think it has to do with the upcoming anniversaries of you know, the Magic Kingdom and whatnot. So I'm really excited. Can't wait.
Yeah, absolutely. And I feel that... yeah, with everything, it's all changing over there. Like, that was the thing about Hollywood Studios, is we were trying to figure out, because we only went 2 days, so we were trying to figure out whether to do Magic Kingdom. Well, we did Magic Kingdom the first day, that was a no-brainer, and then we were trying to figure out if we want to do Animal Kingdom, or Epcot, or Hollywood Studios, and we really wanted to check out Rock and Roller Coaster, and we love Twilight Tower of Terror, and we wanted to make sure we did that one more time before, I think... That was before we knew that they were turning Tower of Terror into Guardians of the Galaxy here, but it's beside the point. Anyway, we chose to do Hollywood Studios, but then when we got there, there was just so much going on with walls that are up, and they're working on Toy Story Land, and with Star Wars Land, so...
Yeah, there is a lot going on at Hollywood Studios. There's a lot going on at Walt Disney World in general. I know they just announced a huge, the biggest undertaking that they've done is actually going to be at Epcot. I'm really excited to see what that entails. They say they're going to stick true to Walt's original idea, but kind of revamp the park. And I'm really interested to see what that's going to look like, because I do love Epcot. It's a personal favorite, I think.
Yeah, and it was really hard for me to choose between Epcot and Hollywood Studios, because I've heard so much good stuff about Epcot. But that was the thing, is that it felt... We were looking at some of the things, and I mean, I don't mean to put Ellen's Energy Adventure on the spot, but I mean, I was watching that and I was like, oh my goodness, this is super outdated.
Yeah. And
so the fact that they're going to go back in there and maybe hopefully kind of spruce things up a little bit, I think is going to be super great, and it'll be a, I think it'll attract more people to that park. Which will be good, because then at that point we'll have Star Wars Land, and everybody's going to want to go to Hollywood Studios for that. So I think the fact that everything is getting spruced up is cool, because then we can have more people in different spots.
Right, I think what a lot of people fail to realize is that Disney is giving something for everyone in Disney. Like I was saying earlier, with the Magic Kingdom, you have this very whimsical fantasy land that you would enjoy with your kids. And don't get me wrong, you'll enjoy all of Walt Disney World with your kids, but more than likely, if your kids under the age of 12. Magic Kingdom is it for them. They love Magic Kingdom. But if you're a little bit older, you know, you're looking at maybe like the 13 to 20, you know, you hear a lot of about Epcot or Animal Kingdom. And I know for a fact adults love Epcot, because of the dining and the drinking around the world and trying different cultures. Don't get me wrong, some kids love it. There's always the exclusions, but I know adults love Epcot, and I think that's what they're trying to do, is they're giving Hollywood Studios is going to be the thrills and the crazy cool stuff that your tweens and teens are going to love, and then Magic Kingdom's going to be kind of for your kids and kids at heart, and Epcot's going to be kind of for your older crowd that wants to try different cuisines from around the world, and there's still going to be some stuff like Frozen Ever After that the kids are still going to get excited about the parks, but I think they're trying to gear each park at an audience to, like you said, kind of disperse it so that you're not getting everybody to Star Wars Land right now kind of thing.
Yeah, exactly. And the edutainment thing that was really big in the 90s and is still obviously big there, but when they were creating these new pieces of technology back in the Disney decade, I think is what it was. You know, it was just the fact that you could learn while you were having a ton of fun. And I feel that that is so important to society today, because it's getting to a point where these theme parks are all about the thrills. And that's the thing about Epcot, is that it's always been a place where you can learn and you can also go ride Test Track. But you're also learning on Test Track, you know? It's this, I really hope that they keep that part, that aspect of it together, because then it gives, you know, as you said, it's full circle, and you've got all the different types of things with the cuisine from all the different pavilions.
I agree 100%, man. I think what you're looking at is Epcot. It was of its time, right? So learning things happened in a different manner. You didn't have the internet, so when you learned things, it was really cool. But now that we have anything we could ever want to know literally in my pocket at all times, you've got to think of a different approach to get people to learn. And I think that's where Test Track and things of that nature, these thrills that teach you, and Mission Mars, you know, things like that, they teach you, but they don't, like, they trick you into learning, I guess is what I'm getting at.
You
go into Mission Mars and you find out about, like, going around the moon to have a gravity boost that'll increase your speed. And people are like, wait a minute, what? And, like, they come out and they just know it, but they didn't realize that they just learned. But they did. You learned a little bit of something when you were going to Mars.
Yeah, and that's super cool. And the fact that it is outdated is pretty... It's sad to me, because the fact that, you know, we have everything at our fingertips, it's kind of like, oh, that's kind of boring now. Whereas with this new update that you're talking about, I think that they could really continue to hone in on that aspect of it, so that you could continue to learn about things you may not be looking up on the internet, but also still having fun. And then you can rattle off those facts, which is cool. It's like, yeah, we use the gravitational pull. It's like, wait, how do you know that? Oh, it was Epcot.
Exactly. You learn without knowing. So that's kind of cool. I like I said, I hope the same thing. I hope that they keep that original idea, but kind of give it a modern twist so that people are learning and they don't know it.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. It's very cool. Couple more things. We're gonna do a quick rapid fire of favorites. Before we get to that, are you planning on seeing a candlelight processional when you guys go on? You said December 16th, something like that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we might. Right now, we are still fighting for that monorail reservation, and we've got a pretty tight schedule. We still might, though. I can't remember who the person was. If it was Neil Patrick Harris, the answer would be yes, 100 times yes. I saw him and was like, oh, we're gonna see him, but I think he leaves like the day before I get there, so I'm a little bummed about that.
We were I watched the WDW live stream of it, and I got to see his performance, and it was spectacular. It was so great, but he said he was only gonna
like everything he does.
Oh yeah, yeah, absolutely. I'm so excited for the new Netflix series of series of unfortunate events. I think he's gonna be awesome as Count Olaf.
Yeah, he's perfect for that kind of a role.
Oh, absolutely. I think it'll be cool. All right. Well, absolutely gonna need a trip report when you come back. It sounds like you're gonna have a blast. And how in the world are you gonna score this monorail dining thing? That sounds awesome.
Oh, man. So I guess the day that it was announced, and for those of you who don't know, Disney announced a new dining package or plan. I think it's a very limited time engagement. You start, it's the monorail crawl, but actually done by Disney. It's $150 a person, but it includes your drinks and your meal. And it also includes watching Wishes from the Polynesian. So you get on at the Polynesian or the Contemporary. One of the two. You get on at the Polynesian or the Contemporary, then you go to the next one, then you go to the next one. And at each stop, you have like an appetizer and a drink, and then you have your meal and a drink, and then you go and you have dessert and coffee while watching Wishes. And it's so cool. It just blows my mind. And it's all like catered and stuff. It's really, really cool. And I'm hoping we get it. We've been trying since day one to get it. Like literally, I think I want to say it was like 8 hours after they announced that, I confirmed with my wife and I was calling.
Yeah, that'll be a really cool experience. And you said that it was already sold out 8 minutes in. I mean, how do you think you're going to get it from there? Have you been going through like travel planners and that kind of thing?
Yeah, I mean, I guess with all things Disney like this, somebody called in and probably booked like 5 nights, not knowing which night they're going to go. So we're just going to keep calling and keep trying. We scored Be Our Guest breakfast reservations the same way. So
we're just going to keep plugging away. We did the same thing. Yeah. So I had a reservation, I forget when it was, but I was looking on my Disney experience like a couple weeks before we left. And I was scrolling through reservations, and I clicked Be Our Guest, and they said breakfast was available. And I'm, like, running through the house, like, oh, my gosh, oh, my gosh. And everybody's like, what happened? And I was like, we just got breakfast at Be Our Guest. And they were like, what does that even mean? And I was like, you will not even know until we get there. And then we got there, and it was so good, and we got to sit in the room with the rose. And
yeah.
It was just awesome. And then we also got Skipper Canteen that way, too. Like, we were there, like, a week before. It was on a week before, and I saw that Skipper Canteen was there, and I ended up having to cancel one of them and just did that instead. Because I was like, how am I so lucky that I got both of these in one single day? It was an epic day. It was so great.
Yeah. One of those days you got to buy a lotto ticket or something when you're old enough, man.
Oh, yeah. For sure. All right, so we're going to go into our rapid-fire section of the show really quickly before I let you go. Nick, it has been so fun. I have super enjoyed talking to you about all this kinds of stuff. But here we go. We're going rapid-fire. Set your clocks, set your everything. Here we go. We're going favorite park at Walt Disney World out of the four or six, if you count the water parks.
Right now, it's going to be Epcot just because I'm hungry and I'm thinking about all those different restaurants.
Nice. What about your favorite land in Magic Kingdom?
Tomorrowland, no doubt, man. Even love the movie. I know a lot of people didn't, but I love Tomorrowland.
Okay, so what is the deal about everybody was like, oh, yeah, Tomorrowland was like, okay. I watched it. It was so good. Like, and the ties in.
I think a lot of people didn't give it a chance. The first guy came out and was like, it's bad. And then everybody was like, yeah, what he said. And I'm like, did you even watch it?
Yeah, come on.
Give it a chance. It's really good. I love the movie. So if you haven't seen it and you're out there, go watch it. It's really good.
I enjoyed it as well. And I kind of felt like that was the shift when Disney decided, they were like, yeah, Tron 3, you're getting the boot because we didn't do well with Tomorrowland. And I was like, hey! I was waiting for that.
Exactly, yeah. It was a victim of poor marketing, so.
Yeah. Okay, speaking of Tomorrowland, what is your favorite ride there?
In Tomorrowland? Oh, man, it's going to be Carousel of Progress, actually. Favorite song, too. I love it.
We were there with my family the last time, and I just lean over to my dad, and I start singing it. Because I used to watch or listen to Inside the Magic before Ricky was done. And, you know, they had the song at the very end of every single episode. So I lean over to my dad and just start singing. He's like, how do you know this? It was like, don't you know? I'm a nerd. Like, I obviously have figured this out somehow. Okay, and, all right. Favorite movie?
Favorite movie? That is Sword in the Stone.
Oh, yeah. Yes.
I don't know if you can see it. I have a painting my wife did of Archimedes first year we were dating.
That's
favorite movie.
Awesome. Very, very cool. If only guys like us could pull the sword out of the stone. If only they would last.
I know! You have no idea how frustrating that, like, and I'm a big muscular guy, so I'll never get to do it because then it looks like too cliche. Like, yeah. Ah, of course the muscular guy. So, like, kids are walking by and I'm like, I want to pull it out. I want to do it. Nope, not for me.
You just have to have a kid and then have the kid go do it and then just, like, hold on to him and so you guys do it at the same time. It's like, yeah, I did it! It's like,
exactly,
no, Dad,
I technically did it. Yeah.
All right, so we're going with favorite character.
Favorite character. I King Mickey from Kingdom Hearts. I'm gonna go with Mickey, but King Mickey is my favorite.
Okay. That was a game for people who don't know, kind of like me. I'm a little on the fence, or I'm a little uncultured when it comes to video games and Mickey Mouse. So Kingdom Hearts came out for what console in what year? Do you remember?
I don't remember the year, but it came out for PlayStation. There's Kingdom Hearts 1 and 2, and plus a whole bunch of other little ones that came out for different consoles. But it was a team up between Square Enix, and who does Final Fantasy, and Disney. And they did not expect it to do anything, but it is actually the most anticipated game of the decade, I want to say. Kingdom Hearts 3 is. So it's very cool. You play as an anime character who runs around fighting bad guys, but you get help from all the different Disney movies. It's really cool.
I remember they released an iOS version of it earlier in the year, and I got to play it for a little while, and I was super stoked on it. It took up a ton of space, so I eventually had to delete it, but it looked really, really cool and really fun. I'm going to have to see if I can get it from my PlayStation 3 so that I can check it out for sure.
Yeah, man, it's definitely a blast.
Yeah, absolutely. Okay, so if you're in the parks, what is your favorite character to go meet with? To go meet and greet with?
Can't meet him anymore. Can't meet him anymore, but it's Figment.
Oh,
yeah,
nice.
Yeah, Dreamfinder with Figment, man. He was awesome. He was walking around. He had an actual... he was a puppet as opposed to like a full character. And Dreamfinder obviously was a face character, but it was... Oh, I love it. It was awesome.
Did you happen to read the, I think it was the Disney Kingdoms comics with Figment
yes.
and Dreamfinder?
Oh, yeah. I've read all the Disney Kingdoms. If you haven't, everybody needs to go check it out.
Yeah, absolutely. I got to Seekers of the Weird, and then I never ended up getting the rest of them, but that's what I'm asking for Christmas, for sure.
There you go.
Absolutely. So, that's your favorite character to meet in the park. That's awesome. What about favorite character from the parks? So I'm talking people like the Hatbox Ghost. And I guess Figment and Dreamfinder is the same kind of thing. But if you were to pick someone other than those guys.
Let's see. Oh, man. I don't know, man. You got me on the spot here.
Sorry to keep doing that.
It's fine. Gaston keeps coming up, but he's not really he's an actual character. We don't have too many at Walt Disney World like you guys do. Like, you've got like the Hatbox Ghost and things like that. We really have like Figment, Dreamfinder. I don't know, man.
With the favorite character from Disney World, I'd probably say Albert AWOL from the AWOL Airwaves over at the Jungle Cruise. Have you listened to that loop in its entirety?
I stream loops all the time. I love it. You know what? I hear you. The mayor of Main Street. If you haven't
there
found
you
this
go.
Guy, awesome. he is. Oh man, I love meeting him. He's such an adorable character. Like he just reminds me of everybody's grandfather ever. Like, I just want to hug him myself and be like, ha.
That's awesome.
He's got such a hearty laugh. He's great.
Yeah, absolutely. And with the loops, I'll stream them when I'm doing homework and that kind of thing and when I'm falling asleep. But it's such a fun way to feel like you're back at the parks. Absolutely.
Exactly. 100%.
Yeah. Okay, so we're going next to your favorite soundtrack from a movie.
Favorite soundtrack from a movie? We're going with Mulan. Pretty much anything from that Disney era, like the Disney Renaissance. But Mulan is definitely, love that movie.
All right, very, very cool. Okay, what about your favorite Disney snack? If you were to go anywhere in any of the parks, where would you be getting your snack and what would it be?
I would be getting a Dole Whip, and I would just be sitting there eating a Dole Whip the whole time. Like, that's Dole Whip 24/7. I would live off of them if I could.
Okay, so we went into the Tiki Room when we were there, and I was super expecting it to have a Dole Whip stand inside of it, because that's how it is in Disneyland.
Yeah.
And so I walk in, and the door's closed, and I was like, wait a second, and then it starts. And
where do I get my Dole Whip?
Yeah, exactly. And so then we walk out the other side, and then obviously I got it, and I was a very happy person, but I was like, what happened? Like, I didn't know that. It was really funny, but then we got to experience the whole thing, and it was really rad.
Yeah.
All right, favorite, we've got two more. Favorite Disney restaurant.
Favorite Disney restaurant. Gosh, I love so many of the restaurants, but I'm gonna, I don't know. I'm gonna go with Chef Mickey's, just because it has like some memories for me. It's the first character dining I've ever done. You know, I had it with my grandparents, and awesome. You spin your freaking napkin around your head, and it's just a blast.
Absolutely. I remember at the Disneyland Hotel, there's something a little bit like that. Obviously, Chef Mickey's is a little bit cooler, but it was a character dining experience for sure. Aladdin came over and said, hey, and we took pictures together. This is when I was 6. And so I just remember that as one of the really... Oh, yeah, and then you hear this giant sound effect of all these plates falling down, and then Goofy goes up to the loudspeaker and is like, I need to go pick up all the plates! And then you all run over there and go help him. Just that kind of cool stuff.
That's awesome.
And so, speaking of memories, what's your favorite Disney memory?
Oh, man. My wife would kill me if I didn't say when we got engaged. But I'm going to say that is my official statement. I guess the real one is... the real one is just anytime I'm with my family. There's something about being in the parks and being in Disney with your family, both present and ones that have passed. And when you go into the parks, even if you're not with those people, it has a way of bringing you back to being with those people and keeping that memory alive. And it's really just a heartwarming experience. The smells, the sounds, it just comes together in one package that can take you back as far as you want it to, or it can help you enjoy the now. So just anytime you're with family.
That was perfect. That was so great. I completely agree. That is good. And it's okay. Your wife probably doesn't listen to this show anyway, so it's all good.
She's probably sitting outside of the door right now with a glass, like doing that, like, yeah.
She's got that hatchet. You're going to be the next one in the Haunted Mansion.
Yeah. There you go. I am the 1,000th.
Good stuff. All right, Nick. Well, it has been so fun to talk to you. I appreciate you coming on the show. It's been we've been trying to get this going for a little while, and we finally got it together, and I'm super stoked to get to talk to you. Where can people find you on the socials?
You can find me pretty much anywhere at The Diz Dude, facebook.com/TheDizDude, Instagram, Twitter, all those places is going to be at The Diz Dude, DIZDUDE. Instagram, iTunes, rather. You can go on there, The Disney Dude Podcast, Stitcher, iTunes, SoundCloud, all those places you can find me. So just check it out if you get the time, and drop me a line. I love hearing from people.
Yeah, very, very cool to get to talk to you and communicate. And you were telling me a little bit before the show about a little secret project you were working on. Do you want to tell the two listeners that are listening to this what's going on there?
I'll give a little hint. Just check out facebook.com/DizCentral, D-I-Z Central. It's going to be awesome. It's very secretive right now. A lot of people don't know what it is, but let's just say it's a place for everybody who is interested in Disney. No matter how technologically advanced you are, no matter what your thoughts are, this is going to be a place for everyone.
You guys heard it on Turning Onto Harbor first. Diz Central. It's going to be a thing. It's going to be great.
Yeah. Thanks, man. Have a good one.
All right, Nick. Well, it has been a blast. I super appreciate it. And this has been episode 5 of Turning on Harbor. Thank you so much for listening. Be sure to share it with all of your friends. And Nick, we'll see you next time. See ya.